We rarely hear about children in foster care because the law protects their privacy. But thanks to a lawsuit filed in Davidson County, we get an inside look at a teenage girl where the system let her down not once, but twice. The victim, whose name we're not going to reveal, was sexually assaulted inside this group home in Lexington known as the Hasty House. Tanya Williams, a foster parent, was convicted of taking indecent liberties with the child placed in her care. Today, Williams is a registered sex offender. As for the victim, she tried to kill herself following the incident, overdosing on drugs she found inside Hasty House. As bad as that had to be for a 13-year-old girl, it was about to get worse. The system that was designed to protect her was about to let her down again. After recovering from the drug overdose, the girl was placed in what's known as a therapeutic foster home in Greensboro. It was supposed to be safer than a group home, just her and a married couple living together. But her foster father sexually assaulted her. Gifted Robinson is now serving a 19-year sentence in state prison for statutory rape, indecent liberties, and sexual assault by someone in a parental role. 58 years old at the time, Robinson confessed to abusing the child in his care. Following a similar pattern in her life, the girl attempted suicide with a drug overdose. This time it happened at Guilford Middle School, where she was a student.
I don't remember any that were horrible as this particular one.
The head of the North Carolina Children's Home Society, which operated the therapeutic foster care home in Greensboro where the victim was placed, says there have been no more than 5 cases during his 30 years on the job where a child was sexually abused under his care. He says none worse than this one.
He did things that again, it's hard to imagine someone would do.
Social workers at the children's home say they vetted Gifted Robinson and his wife before the state licensed them as a therapeutic foster care home.
We had done everything that we were supposed to do.
Both administrators say the children's home didn't make any changes in the vetting process in light of what happened.
When you're dealing with human beings, there just is no way, and this is not an excuse, it's just a fact, there's no way that you can ever say that you know either everything.
To have a situation that happens after they come into our care is very disturbing, because we are here to protect children.
The public agency responsible for the safety of our unnamed victim is Davidson County Social Services.
We have not had anything like that.
The head of social services says his department relies on public trust, worries that making this story public could undermine that trust. The assaults happened before he became director, and he says he doesn't know if any changes were made.
You were asking what we could do, what we should do at this point. I think we should pray for that person, for them to be able to get peace and have comfort in what's going on. It has happened. It should never happen again.
This case is 10 years old and would have remained a secret if the victim not filed a lawsuit back in 2009. The case was dropped a year later and the victim's lawyer committed suicide. No one we asked knows why the lawsuit was dropped. I spent nearly an hour talking with this victim. She says that she changed her name in an effort to help her to forget about her past. She tells me that she blames social workers for what happened to her. She says they didn't investigate the complaints that she made and allowed the sexual abuse to go on for months. Today she's 24 years old, married with 3 kids, but says her troubles are not over. She told me, quote, "I'm afraid of everyone and everything." She says no one ever apologized to her for what happened, and today still wishes that someone had. Back to you.